very Monday morning. So sorted out now on four with the big breakfast.
To the show. It's a Monday morning, and today this is an empty chair at the moment. You can see that. But we've got a surprise for you, the viewers, which I think you're going to like. I've got a special guest host today, folks. Yes, it's none other than winner of ITV's Survivor, Charlotte Hobrough! Tremendous to be, have a seat, to be hosting the show with a millionaire S.
Fantastic.
Great to have you here. Charlotte,
thank you.
Do you prefer Charlotte Hobrough or Charlotte the Harlot?
Charlotte Hobrough, I think. The other gag's a bit unoriginal.
Okay.
Now,
well, you'll find that a lot of the gags on the show are.
I'll say no more.
Nature of the show. Okay, but that was the son, I think, that gave you that title.
I know,
and I know that's something that has annoyed you.
Well, it hasn't annoyed me. I mean, I have a little bit of a laugh about it every now and again, yeah.
Okay.
You've got a smile, haven't you, at these little stories that come out.
Well, of course. I'm glad that you can, and we will avoid using that title from now on.
You've
won £1 million.
That's £1 million,
everyone. Have you spent any of that money yet?
Well, no, but I'm trying my best to.
Okay,
so
well, good luck.
Coming up soon.
Good luck. Of course, Survivor is made by the production company that makes this show.
That's right.
Are you being paid for this gig as well?
Oh, I wouldn't like to say, but you know, the money
just,
for old
just taking more money from us. We're not needed.
Exactly,
okay.
I know.
Listen, good luck with
you.
Your presenting. And here we go, a bit of presenting, which we're going to enjoy.
That's right, exactly.
Let's find out what's happening on this morning's show.
Great.
Okay, go.
Next of all, I'll be meeting our brand new family of the week. Yeah.
Were you Survivor fans? Say yes.
Yeah.
Tremendous.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what we like to hear.
At 7:15, one of my favourite sections of the week, Jody Bunting is telling you, our viewers, how to lose some weight. Yeah. Jody! What are we working on this morning?
We're going to be working the heart in the summer workout.
Oh, this is
exciting stuff. At 7:20, we've got a brand new look at the chart.
Okay, excellent. It's going very well, Charlotte.
Thank you.
Plus, as promised, well, I haven't promised you, I mentioned it on Friday. He's here, he's live in the house, none other than Steve Coogan! Coogan throughout this morning. Now, though, and it's...
It's time for the news and weather with Jasmine Lester.
Oh, welcome.
Yes. Thank you. Good morning. These are the main stories on Monday, the 6th of August. Body found in Aussie outback. Maddie's the most enviable of them all. And Maurice leaves them green. Australian police investigating the disappearance of British tourist Peter Falconio say they've discovered a body. However, they believe it's unlikely to be that of the 28-year-old tourist. It was found near the city of Alice Springs, 200 miles south from where Mr. Falconio and his girlfriend Joanne Leese were attacked in the Northern Territory over 3 weeks ago. Police say it was not wearing the same clothes as described by Ms. Leese at the time of the abduction. Police are expected to release an e-fit of a man they believe is responsible for planting the Ealing car bomb. Anti-terrorist investigators working in West London are hoping to finish their forensic fingertip search of the scene. They're keen to lift more of the cordons around the area devastated by Friday's blast and allow life to get back to normal as soon as possible.
We want to get residents back into their homes, living life as normal as possible, traders up and running as quickly as possible, and the road open as quickly as possible.
Doctors are warning students going on a gap year abroad to practice safe sex. A new report shows an increase in numbers picking up sexually transmitted diseases on their travels. Last year, they found a 28% rise in youngsters returning home HIV positive. Residents in W's home state of Texas were forced to evacuate their homes after a train derailed carrying toxic material. 20 carriages fell off the track in Montgomery County. One of the containers was transporting a skin corrosive toxin called benzene. The latest attempt to be the first to fly a balloon solo around the world is into its second day. US millionaire Steve Fossett is expected to cross over Australia's east coast later, heading out over the Pacific Ocean towards New Zealand. The 57-year-old has already been forced to leave the capsule to repair a satellite antenna. Madonna's been voted the most enviable woman on the planet. A poll of British women placed the pop icon at the top of the pile for having the best bank account, brains and career. Posh Spice got the prize for best dressed, while former Spice mate Jerry hit a flat note, topping the worst voice category. Page 3's stunner Jordan was the least envied for her talent and career. Here's the sport. Maurice Greene picked up his third successive 100 metres title at the World Athletics Championships in Edmonton last night. The Kansas Cannonball clocked 9.82 seconds, with Britain's Dwayne Chambers coming in fifth. Earlier, British hopes ended in the men's 400 metres. Mark Richardson and Ewan Thomas both failed to qualify from their semi-finals. With seven straight Ashes series wins over England, Australia's cricketers are demanding their prize. Aussie cricket captain Steve Waugh called on the old boys at Lord's to hand over the Ashes urn. Despite the Aussies' unbeatable 3-0 win at Trent Bridge, MCC officials say the Ashes belong to the club. Here's the weather. Temperatures should range from a low of 14 degrees in the Shetlands to 22 degrees in and around London. Expect a dull and cloudy start to the day with rain in many parts of Britain. Later showers will spread throughout the land, leaving only those in the north of Scotland dry. Here's the 5-day forecast. Scotland and Northern Ireland will be cloudy and wet, but there will be the occasional glimpse of the sun too. In northern and central regions, the weather will improve as the weekend approaches, and the south follows a similar trend with wet weather early in the week, followed by a dry period spell towards the weekend. That's it now. It's back to Richard and Charlotte.
Terrific, Jasmine, and another fine bulletin from you. And thank you very much. Unfortunately, although you know I enjoy chatting to you and we have an excellent dialogue, you've got some nice eye makeup on today. Is that different?
Have I got different eye makeup?
Yes.
No, I think my eyes are just a bit puffy and tired.
Have you had your hair done?
I've done my roots, yes.
Have you? Well, it looks just tremendous.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, there isn't the time to chat because I've got a special guest here.
Yeah, sure. I understand.
Do you? I'm glad. So it's time to do this. Jasmine Lowson. Charlotte, did you, by the way, I don't know if you sleep well last night?
No, not really. You know, I only slept for about an hour.
Were you nervous about meeting me?
Oh, I was petrified, you know. This big idol and everything.
Well, obviously, yes.
So frightening.
That's not in question.
I don't know how you live with it.
I know, it's very hard. I didn't sleep. What are you laughing at? to be honest, I didn't sleep very well. I made myself some salmon, and I think it's a bit ropey, and it kept me awake all night. It was poached salmon with dill. But anyway, the point is...
So you weren't frightened about meeting me?
No, but I was looking forward to it.
And this is
one of the reasons, because obviously you're my special guest host today.
Right.
And you won, as we said already, £1 million!
I know!
Television.
I keep forgetting.
Okay. did this show offer you any advice on how best to look after the money?
They said give it all here, give it back.
Did they?
I said, you're not having it.
Well, what we're doing this morning is rather than paying you, I've since discovered, what you're doing is actually giving away some of your money.
So
it's a chance for you, the viewers, to win Charlotte's money this morning.
Yeah. And here it is, right in my little handbag. This is mine. And £1,000! But to get your hands on this money, you have got to do something a little bit extraordinary and come up with an exciting limerick on me, apparently. No rude ones, though, thank you.
That's a nice idea. So there we are, there's £1,000. And it's Charlotte's grand giveaway. Fan it towards the camera, it's real money.
Loads of money.
Just phone us with your limerick. I, myself, have already written one for you.
Thank you. I'm sure it's really sweet.
There was a young lady from Wales who didn't mind dining on snails. She camped by the shore, gave the others what for, and now enjoys champagne cocktails.
Yes! For breakfast every morning! Thank you!
Thanks very much.
You have won!
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You can't do better than that. But if you can, call us on the usual number, which is 029.
No,
020-8985. And all the ones.
Okay.
I nearly gave away my home phone number there.
Did you? Don't do that. That
don't ring me on that. I've had enough funny phone calls.
Yeah, a major security risk. Okay. Do remember that Charlotte is Welsh, an ex-police officer, and she's a good-looking lass. And of course, she's a millionaire.
Yay!
Okay. Now.
But now.
Go on.
It's time to meet the brand new family of the week.
Yay!
They may not grab the headlines. They're not richer on the breadline. Kids, we've got deadlines. Here's family of the week.
Hi, we're the Atkinsons from Ilfracombe, North Devon.
This is Mum. She loves being in the spotlight.
I'd just like to say thank you to my mum for having me, my husband for making it possible, my children, and the world. I love you.
This is Cole, who's 10, and Callum, who's 6, and they think they're so cool.
This is Tia. She's 12, a disco diva who doesn't let the boys cramp her style.
This is Dad. He loves having control of the TV. He just wishes he could turn the kids off sometimes.
And here they are with us now, our brand new family of the week.
Woo!
First of all, we got Mum Mandy. You'll have to, so I can see your names.
Hi.
Dad Mark, daughter Tia, and Carl, and also there's Callum. Now, how old are you all? You're 6. Yeah, and how old are you?
10.
Ooh. And you're the oldest of the family. Excellent. Welcome to the show, everybody.
Yay.
Are you all really excited about being on the show?
Yeah.
And nervous? Well, that's right. Hey, loads of money. And what are you looking forward to most this week?
Meeting stars, people.
Stars, anybody in particular? Richard Bacon. Being on TV. You've always fancied being on TV, have you? Excellent. What's your favourite programmes? The Big Breakfast! Do you want to say?
Do you have the favourite shows?
Do you get up early in the morning?
What shows do you like? It's a good question. Carl? You don't have to answer.
Wrestling.
Just
tell
him.
Yes. Big fan of wrestling, I understand. It's an excellent choice.
Exciting stuff. Do you think you could do that, though? When you're a bit bigger, perhaps.
Well, who knows?
Right. Well, as you all know, every brand new family of the week has to give the lowdown on each other. So now it's time to dish the dish. But as you know, I'm an ex-policewoman and I'm used to interrogating people, so bear with me as I must wear this while I do it, OK? Does it look smart?
Lovely.
Have you got one like this? It's very nice. I thought it was yours, actually. Right, so first of all, we've got Mandy, I think. You can start with Dad.
Dish it!
The dirt on Dad, don't we? So, Mandy, what can you tell us about Mark here?
Well, when my Sky bill comes in each month, there's always extra charges for the adult channels.
No!
That's disgraceful. Sorry. What is the adult channel? No, we won't go into that.
Discovery.
Really? Discovering what? Yes, I'm sure you don't know anything about that.
Yeah, right.
But I think you're a little bit young for this. You obviously don't watch it, do you? No, of course not. Carl. I think you've got a little bit of a secret about young Callum here.
Yes.
Dish the dirt. Come on.
He's always pulling moonies in public.
Oh, no way! You don't, do you?
Oh.
Do you do that then, Callum?
No.
You don't? No. I think Carl does, doesn't he?
Yeah.
So who do you pull the moonies to then? Who does he pull the moonies to?
Loads of people.
Really? Say no more. That's quite exciting stuff. So you're denying this allegation, are you? See, I'm definitely in policewoman mode here.
Yes, yeah.
You don't do anything like that at all. Tia, seeing as Carl's dropped Callum in it, what can you tell us about young Carl here?
Carl's got an annoying habit of dressing up in women's clothes.
Oh, really? Oh, dear, I've got to see this. And what exactly does he like to wear?
Oh, my skirts and vest tops.
And Carl, what have you got to say about this young man?
Don't know.
You don't know? Is it true?
Yeah.
It's just for fun, though, isn't it? It's pantomime things. Like a pantomime dame.
Me and my cousin do it.
You and your cousin, and who's your cousin?
Ben.
Ben who? Less embarrassing.
Hopkins.
Too. Ben Hopkins. Oh. We know all about you. So who? How did this start? You just decided one day that you fancied wearing a skirt. Say no more. Can't fault it. Quite exciting stuff. And Mark,
Mum, this is your moment. What can you tell us about dear Mandy here?
Well, she went to an Anne Summers party once and...
I'm getting worried about your family.
And she bought a toy.
And, really? Would you like to elaborate?
No! No.
Nothing which resembles any of this breakfast.
No!
That's all right then. Just the cooked breakfast.
And one of the children, they found it upstairs and come down when she had some friends around and asked what it was.
That's fantastic! What did you say? It's a microphone. Am I thinking along the right lines here? Perhaps we won't go any further into this one. So do you often go to these Anne Summers parties then?
It's my first one.
Really? That's what they all say, but we'll let you off this time. And finally, we've got Carl to dish the dirt on young Tia. The big sister. What can you tell us about Tia?
She fancies Robbie Kift.
Oh, and who is Robbie Kift?
It's a boy in our school.
A boy. And which school do you go to?
The comp.
Yeah. Which comp? What's it called?
Ilfracombe College.
Ilfracombe Comprehensive. And what's his name again? Robbie Kift. Are you watching this? After the break, we're losing it with Jody. But first, here's what's coming up.
Coming up on this week's star-studded Big Breakfast, top funny man Ben Miller gives us the lowdown on his hilarious new movie. We get Out of Control with Dance Masters The Roots and UK Garage Kings, DJ Luck and MC Neats. We'll be popping in for a chat. Plus, in Snap, we catch up with Angelina Jolie and Antonio Banderas at the premiere of their new movie. We talk Aya Napa with dance gurus Groove Armada, plus the return of Brit Rockers Embrace. All this and much, much more on The Big Breakfast. Don't leave home without it.
Now, if you're struggling to get into your swimwear this summer, then why not either go to In for Survivor 2 or try and lose it with our fitness expert, Jody Bunting. Every week, Jody. Hiya, Jody. How are you?
Hi there. You okay,
you're
Charlotte?
Excited?
I am. Yes,
mood?
I am.
Excellent.
Yes.
That's what we like to hear. Looking nice and fit today. Every
Thank
week,
you.
Jody's here on the show to keep you trim, and of course, he's losing a few pounds himself.
We
Isn't
are.
That right?
Yes. First of all, I'd like to explain that muscle does weigh heavier than fat.
Well,
okay?
Yes. We'll be the judge of that, Jody.
We've been weight training every single day, so
Excellent.
We've got some serious muscle on this body today. Serious muscle.
I can see it rippling.
Shall we hop on there?
Okay. Up until now, you've lost 9 pounds.
That's right, we did lose 9 pounds
brilliant.
Last week.
So let's see what you've lost.
Remember, muscle is heavier.
Week.
Muscle is heavier. Muscle is heavier.
You've weighed
muscle
yourself before
heavier.
Coming on here, haven't you?
No.
Let's have a look. Oh, hang on, it keeps 25 stone and one pound.
Right,
no way.
So, we've lost,
That's
we've put
excellent.
On 3 pounds, but it is serious muscle. Yeah. Serious muscle, okay.
But so, before we get going with this week's workout, it's time for
food for thought. Jodie's food for thought.
This week we're going to find out that size matters. No matter how healthy you try and be, I know cakes and sweets can be tempting, but there is a solution.
So you won't be needing any of these.
If you absolutely must have a treat, then keep it small because size matters. If you must indulge, keep it and your waistline small.
Thank you, Jody. What part of the body are we working on?
We're working
at the
on the heart today. We're going to have a high energy summer workout.
Excellent. Ooh. Hey, and what music are we doing it to?
We've got Man Child and It's Nothing Without Me.
Hey. Superb. Now, here's your chance to get fit in the comfort of your own bedroom, not in your bed. And let's lose it with Jody. Hey.
Lose it with Jody.
Okay, everybody, it's Monday morning. We're gonna get fit. Here we go. We're gonna walk.
up on the end, and look, another corner. One, two, three, grapevine to the side we go. One, two, three, back, two, three, nice big arms, keep that going. And again, come on, that heart rate's getting up. One, two, three, one more to go, Charlotte, here we go. Step to the side, single, and then we go double, two jacks, stop, and stop. Squat, two steps, two jacks, and again, squat, two steps, and jack, and step. Okay, here we go, one more to go, two jacks, pivot, turn, turn on the right, we go, elbow, elbow, pump, left side, elbow, elbow, pump, right, we go, elbow, elbow, pump, turn, we've got a catchphrase coming on here, turn, turn, come on, really shake that booty, and we're going to turn, and turn, one, two, three, go again, is that heart rate up, I think it is, turn, and again, one, two, three, one more to go, and just jog in on the spot, lift the arms, push, and again, push, push, push it forwards, push it forwards.
Right now, let's keep moving with this week's chart.
Got broken on the road to Mandalay. Every mistake I've ever made has been rehashed and then replayed as I got lost along the way. Bum 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 da da bum bum. Bum 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 da da bum bum.
Kiss in there, and
well,
and can I just say it's going very well, Charlotte. And
thank you.
Having a lot of fun.
Loads of fun.
Okay. Yeah. That song is from the parole officer, Steve Coogan's new film. And Steve here shortly on the show this morning. And Charlotte, let's just say we've got a very special family of the week. I know that.
That's you, right.
You warm to them immensely.
I know, lovely family of the week. Hello, there they are, sat over there.
Okay, now listen, what happens is each week we send you out to complete some tasks. And I understand that, Mandy, you very much hope that your children become famous one day.
Yeah, I want them to be models and on films, everything.
Lovely.
You want them to be models and on films?
Yeah. Okay. They're very talented.
Right, OK, well, that's tremendous. I mean, perhaps it might be better to be more specific than models and on films. You don't know exactly
who wants to be a model, okay. And boys want to work on TV.
OK, that's terrific.
Oh,
well,
excellent.
As a treat for you, what we're doing is we are going to be sending your children this week to different talent schools each day, ooh, and then they're going to report back to us. And today, we're sending you to probably the most famous of all. It's the Sylvia Young Theatre School.
Have you heard of that one?
Of course you have, haven't you, Tim?
Excellent.
That's where Baby Spice went, and some other blondes. They're all blonde who go
they
there.
They are all blonde.
All Saints went there.
That's why I went blonde. I thought, hey, look,
Trippiness.
Here I am.
And listen, good luck with that, and we'll report to us later in the week. Here's what's coming up on this morning's show, folks.
Next, we've got the woman who's dated over 1,700 men on both sides of
the
Atlantic.
That's it, Rochelle. Well, we'll
Michelle over there.
OK, Steve Coogan is on at 7.40. We're talking to him throughout the morning, and also Charlotte.
And at 7.45, we've got the Stereophonics and Muse at the Witness Festival in Snap, Cackle and Pop.
Also later in Snap, Cackle and Pop, Britney loses her virginity. All that's to come on the
disgraceful.
All that's come on the Big Breakfast with me and with Charlotte the Harlot. Here's a break.
How dare you? Break coming up.
The show on this Monday morning with a millionaire and Charlotte, and
hello.
She's here. And also, Steve Coogan's coming up shortly on the show.
Yay!
He's live with us this morning. Lots
exciting
to talk about.
Stuff.
First of all, though, because it's, it's just seconds are ticking away towards 7:30. I think what we might have to do is come to you early. How many seconds? I'm not filling 25 seconds. Here we go. So, lots happening now. They're live to ITN.
I'll read slowly.
Yes, please.
Usually don't have a problem with that.
Here's Jasmine Lowson.
Good morning. These are the main stories on Monday, the 6th of August. Police say Outback Body unlikely to be Peter. Perrier Awards risk losing its fizz. And Greece is set to nick a national treasure. Police investigating the disappearance of a British tourist in central Australia have discovered the body of an unidentified man. However, they think it is unlikely to be that of Peter Falconio, who's been missing since he and his girlfriend Joanne Leese were ambushed over 3 weeks ago just north of Alice Springs. Police say the clothing does not match the type worn by Peter. The body was found about 40 miles south of Alice Springs yesterday afternoon. Scotland Yard are thought to be close to releasing an EFIT photograph of the man they believe planted last week's Ealing bomb. Forensic experts are expected to complete their fingertip search for evidence today, allowing business and homeowners to assess the damage done to their properties. Two people injured in Friday's blast are still in hospital. Today's the day for Northern Ireland's pro-agreement parties, who are supposed to give their response to the latest peace-saving package. But both sides are likely to let the deadline pass. The Ulster Unionists want movement on IRA weapons decommissioning, while Sinn Féin would like more information on police reform. Farmers in the Brecon Beacons will find out the results of foot-and-mouth tests on 4,000 sheep later. More than 6,500 have been culled in the last 9 days. It comes as ministers launch an inquiry into compensation payments made to farmers. Nearly 40 have received £1 million for their livestock.
The annual turnover in excess of £500,000. Assets, probably £3-4 million assets. And it's unrealistic to think that there wouldn't be compensation, wouldn't be in that order.
Past winners of the Perrier Awards at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival are calling for a boycott of this year's prize. Emma Thompson and Rob Newman, who won in 1981, are protesting the marketing of powdered baby milk in developing countries by Perrier's owners Nestlé. Yesterday saw the festival kick off with a parade through the city where some 1,400 shows will take place over the next 3 weeks. Here's the sport. Terry Venables is a wanted man in Greek football arenas. The godfather of football punditry and former England and Australia boss is one of 5 candidates in the running for the vacant position of Greek national coach. He's set to fly out to Athens on Tuesday. Let's hope it doesn't end in tragedy this time. Colin Montgomery secured his Ryder Cup place after winning the Volvo Scandinavian Masters for the 3rd time. He finishes round on 14 under with Lee Westwood and Ian Poulter finishing a shot behind. Meanwhile, Ian Woosnam's caddy Miles Byrne has packed his bag. The golfer sacked him after he overslept and missed the final round of the Scandinavian Masters. Only 2 weeks ago, Byrne was found to be carrying too many clubs, costing the Welshman second place at the Open Championship at Royal Lytham. Here's a look at the weather. Temperatures should range from a low of 14 degrees in the Shetlands to 22 degrees in and around London. Later, most of Britain will be hidden beneath a vast sheet of rain cloud. Only the north of Scotland will escape its clutches. That's it for now. I'll have more at 8.
Tremendous. Thank you very much, Jasmine Lowson. Sex in the City, Annie McBeal. You might get the impression that dating is America's national pastime, but dating is catching on here too. Our next guest has dated over 1,000 American guys and 700 British guys. So to tell us whether a burger with Brad in the Big Apple is preferable to a pie with Pete in Preston, please welcome Rochelle Morton. Lovely. Hello, Rochelle.
702 Englishmen, actually.
Well, I'm sorry about making that small mistake. If only our research had
been
more accurate. Okay, now, Rochelle, what we've done during this interview as well is we've set up a date, because you're going to give some dating advice. There's Charlotte, the winner of Survivor, who we've got here because she's in the news at the moment. And Jody, who is our fitness expert. I mean, in many ways, they're two peas in a pod.
Yes.
You'll be keeping an eye on those for us. Now, let's just clear this up. We say you've dated there altogether 1,702 blokes. That makes you sound a little bit promiscuous.
Yes.
But there was a reason for it, Rochelle.
Yes.
What was that?
Well, initially, it was never for me. It was for a friend who was looking for a date. Mm. And
you went to road test them.
No, listen, we placed the ad to see if there would be any replies.
Yes.
And there were 70, and it just went on and on and on. There were over 1,000 replies, and it's just...
Must have been a good-looking advert. What did the advert say that attracted so much interest?
Female, slim and attractive, seeks professional male for fun times.
Okay.
I mean, very bland,
that's
very, not sexy at all.
OK, tremendous. Now then, so basically, first of all, we're going to talk more. I know you've written a book, which we're going to talk about in a second. Let's see how they're getting on over there. There's Jody, and there's Charlotte. You're going to give them tips, and this is useful for our viewers as well. A lot of them very shy.
Yeah,
I know that you already think they're doing something wrong.
They
what
should
is that?
Not sit together, they should sit opposite.
Why is that?
Oh.
Sit opposite,
do
why is that?
Touching right. And all this fiddling about when you're next to each other. So, I mean, she doesn't know him well enough.
Isn't
for all
there something...
I'm not fiddling about.
Okay.
Anyway.
Okay. Isn't there something more, something more informal and more casual about sitting closer to each other?
No, not on a blind date. You don't know him
okay.
or her.
You make a good point. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. Now, you've obviously... So tell us about some of your American dates as well. Here's your book. This is a book that you've written, My 1,000 Americans.
That's a nice title.
Okay, it's lovely. There we go. Tell us, were there some... I imagine that of the 1,000 American guys, you met some odd people. Would I be right?
Yeah, very right. There's
okay.
A guy that came dressed as a king, because I'm English and I'd obviously be impressed.
So he came dressed as a king?
Yes, he had a crown, the gown,
Which king was it?
Listen, he didn't know. He didn't have a clue.
He'd been to Oodles fancy dress in the fog.
Like with the Hound of the Baskervilles in the background. They've got no idea what goes on here.
Okay.
So it was a king. I was suitably impressed. And, of course, he had no money, just like royalty, so I had to pay for the date.
OK.
So wasn't that good?
Yeah. OK, that's interesting. But I understand that there was quite a dark character, and there was a... Tell me about this guy. This is a rather strange man who turned up with a special gift.
Dead cat in his jacket.
I mean, well, did he explain why he brought a dead cat?
No, I saw the cat. As the cat was coming out, I just took off. And just, I just ran, so I
it's
had
a
no idea.
Phenomenal story, though, isn't
why?
It?
And
it
why
I mean, did you have worries, security worries at that point? You know, I imagine.
Well, the cat was dead.
Scared.
The cat wasn't going to do anything to
no,
me.
I didn't think the cat was a threat.
No,
I just thought,
I saw the cat. I saw the cat, and I just took off. Dead cats in jacket. Don't stay around.
Okay.
Leave.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you're allowed to leave.
That's advice to our viewers. If someone brings a dead cat,
you're allowed
leave.
To leave.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, let's go back live to Charlotte, and let's see how they're getting on. Is there any more? They seem to be fine. Obviously, it's a mock date, but what advice would you give for people who are on a date like this at the early stage of the meal?
Don't drink too much. Ooh. Either of you.
Okay.
You don't know each other. You
don't know each
tipsy
other.
And be silly,
okay.
Do you?
Be silly.
And
sometimes helps things a bit, though, doesn't it? Having
well,
a bit
then
of
you could perhaps lean
a bottle
lean
or
a,
two.
Lean in a little closer.
Oh, right.
And engage each other in conversation.
Yes.
That's nice.
Okay, that's just terrific. Thank you very much. Okay. This is useful advice.
Yeah, of course it is.
Okay.
I'm an expert.
Now, did you discover a big difference? I mean, it's obviously fascinating, research, I would have thought. I mean,
investigative research.
Yes. Did you find a big difference between American blokes and British blokes that you you dated. What was the main differences between
them? There's no difference. They're the same men with different accents. That's all it is. Probably 50% of the guys I met here were married the same in America.
Really?
Really?
That's bad.
That's horrible.
I mean, that's terrible.
That's sad.
So people were just... Did they confess quite easily that they were looking for, you know, an affair or whatever? Is that something they openly volunteered?
Some, you know, as soon as we sat down and we had a drink, they would say, look, I'm here, I'd like to have an affair. Do you like me? I like you. Or that kind of thing.
That's amazing. Okay. Amazing. Cheating is bad. Let's get that on the checklist for our...
No good. Don't
sleazy,
cheat.
Sleazy, isn't it?
Naughty.
Okay, now fine. Just fine. One more bit of advice for Charlotte. There we go, we can see there.
Don't eat with your fingers.
Don't eat with your fingers, it's something she's just done.
Thing is, she's
been eating worms on the desert.
I'm following my lead.
Okay, what would you say? One more final bit of advice.
If the conversation dries up, have a conversation, have a question ready, perhaps it doesn't require a yes or no answer.
Oh, right.
Can you manage that?
Well, I think I might be able to.
Try.
Whereabouts are you going on holiday this year, then?
Well, I've been to Devon, yes, this year.
Exciting! Have you done a bit of surfing down in Devon?
No, you know, just a bit of, you know, keep it on the beach.
Well, that's really good to hear.
I mean, I'll tell you something. I'm glad we've done this item, because if it wasn't, I wouldn't know how to date. I'd be sat there, I'd be on a date, thinking, what am
drinking,
I going to talk about?
Leaning back and being, getting it wrong. Dead cats along, that's it.
Michelle, thank you. Just finally, what were some of the best and worst places that people took you on the dates?
I went to the Four Seasons restaurant in New York. That was fantastic. Yes. And then I went to a very strange
place.
Grocery store in Georgia that had a couple of little dirty formica.
Is that the
tables.
Man with the cat again?
No, it wasn't actually, no.
Okay,
no,
a grocery store. Tremendous.
A grocery store.
Okay, well, you met some dark characters, but, you know, thank you very much. Fascinating conversation.
Thank you.
And I hope it's been of use to our viewers. Listen, thank you very much, Rochelle Morton. Coming up very shortly, we're going to talk to Steve Coogan about his new film, The Parole Officer, and many other things. So, Steve Coogan, after this break.
Yay! In 1941, HMS Hood stalked the battleship Bismarck into the Denmark Straits and engaged in battle. After a direct hit, the pride of the British fleet sunk in 3 minutes, consigned to the icy depths. Now, 60 years on, one man's dream to find the Hood has become a reality. Using the latest equipment in underwater exploration, the hunt for the Hood is over. A fascinating voyage of discovery to unlock the secrets of the deep. Hunt for the Hood, tonight at 9:30 on 4.
Welcome back to the show. Steve Coogan's here this morning. Yay! Sorry about that. It's they do cheer on cue, but they are pleased to see you.
Very.
Okay. Are you all right?
I'm very happy, yes. I'm not used to this. My body clock's a bit out of sync, but
tell us about
I'm ready and...
Yeah, I'll tell you, Monday's a hard work. I stayed awake all night. I was saying earlier, I ate some salmon and it kept me awake all night last night. So we're all feeling a bit that way.
Right, OK.
I don't quite know what's wrong with the salmon.
Whatever you do with salmon, Richard.
No, I just prepared it wrong, didn't I? I didn't really know what I was doing. But the point is, this morning, you'll be excited about this, Steve. We're giving away Charlotte. I don't know if you saw Survivor.
Yeah.
Charlotte's a millionaire.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, it's exciting.
Yes, it is.
Let me know. But I've got £1,000 here, and if you want it, you have got to do better than what we've had. No, I'm only joking. They're not too bad.
What we do is send in some limericks for Charlotte, and you can win yourself £1,000 of her money, and that's genuinely does come from
this is me from your account.
Here's one.
Truly.
This is from Earl Sinclair in Dagenham. There was an ex-policewoman named Charlotte who was sweet, just like chocolate.
Oh, I like that one.
She wore a T-shirt named Wet, the hottest on the set, and was just like a hot pot.
That's not bad. I like the niceties of it.
These were emailed. I imagine if they were written, they'd have been written in crayon. Samantha from Walsall says there was a young woman called Charlotte who was sent to a desert island. She thought it would be a good thing to do, but didn't realise they never had a loo. She had to nip to a tree where she had a pee, And had to reach up and grab a leaf off a tree. That's
just great. That's not bad.
Not, well, I would argue well, not really.
They don't rhyme that well, do they?
They're not really the standard we're looking for. No. So please send us in some decent ones to the big breakfast at channel4.com. OK, listen, coming up in a moment, we're going to talk to Steve Coogan about his new film, The Parole Officer, and a few other things. First of all, here's some showbiz news in Snap, Cackle and Pop.
Today's Snap, Cackle and Pop special, we head to County Meath near Dublin for Ireland's biggest summer gathering, the Witness Festival. We catch up with Wales' finest, the Stereophonics, the Blissed Out Faithless, the Warm Embrace and the Muso's Muse. First up, it's those boyos from the valley, the Stereophonics, who headlined Saturday night.
We usually start off our tours in Ireland and chase our tail for the rest of them.
The Welsh trio have also been touring with Dublin's favourite sons, U2.
We go back tomorrow to Antwerp. We've got two shows in Antwerp and then one in Barcelona. And we've done Stockholm and Paris and Gothenburg, I think.
Copenhagen,
was it? Yeah, it's been really good. Lovely people. Been treated really well, actually. So.
And talking of nice days...
We were swimming there last night in the tent, blowing down the campsite there.
I don't know, the mud was fun. It was good.
That's the lowdown on the dirty. Now, Maxi Jazz on his faithful way of stopping the rain.
You wear your sunglasses if you want the rain to stop, if you need the weather to be good. It's a way of influencing your environment.
Whoa, that's heavy. The complete opposite of Sister Bliss, who has just been in space. Well, nearly. She underwent cosmonaut training in Moscow.
The idea was that I was going to do a bit of DJing up there, but it was so intense, there was no time to do anything except float a bit and then vomit copiously.
And talking of dodgy stomachs, what goes in one end must come out the other.
No toilet roll, you don't flush, there's no water in them, and you might as well just be going on the ground.
It's not too bad. In the warm weather, it's going to be a bit of a smell, like, so... In the cold weather's not too bad, apart from the lorries getting stuck in the muck and things like that there, you know. It's not too bad.
The toilets have been fine, but you have to be very selective about them. You have to, like, you know, open the door and see inside, see if they're you know, clean or sterile or, you know, any way, you know, manageable to go into.
Perhaps time to start afresh. And who better than Danny from Embrace on why festivals are the biz?
It's cool you're in a different country every week and... You get to see loads of different bands and stuff that you wouldn't normally get a chance to see, so yeah.
Yes! Although staying at hotels is a little easier on the soul and soles of your feet.
But this is definitely the best tent. This purple tent here and it's got pink on the front.
But look at that tent. That's Scouts over there. That's the Scouts. Ireland Scouts. A heap of young lads, Scouts running around there last night.
Well. Five-star accommodation, but was it five-star entertainment? Here's Muse on their verdict.
And the crowd, like, they were, like, whipped up. It looked like a
full they're all steaming, and it looked like they were all on fire.
I saw Deftones play in Spain, and the crowd kicked off. It looked a bit like that, because all the steam was coming off, because they were all, like, hot, and the rain steamed. I like that.
And so, finally, yes, it did rain. Yes, there was mud, but every cloud has a silver lining. Or in the case of Witness Festival, a multicoloured one.
Snap, Cackle, and don't go over the top. It's the morning. Shut up. All right, listen, welcome back. I'm joined by one of Britain's favourite fronty men. A very exciting point in the show for me. Here with us, none other than Steve Coogan. He's on the show. Welcome to the show. Steve is, of course, the creator of that legendary character, Alan Partridge.
Steve and Richard, will you go to the Partridge Zone? That's Steve and Richard to the Partridge Zone, please.
Sorry about this, Steve. This is. I know that you'll be pleased about this. We've got a specially erected room for you. And what do you think to that?
It's a bit scary.
It's a bit like the episode in your show.
It is, yeah.
Do
Where's the fire exit?
Do you want to have that seat?
Oh, great.
I think that would be that way you can look at some old pictures of yourself, you see, from there.
Oh, great. Thanks.
Thank you. Now, we're here in the Partridge End. The only place that we're going to mention Alan all morning, because I know that you will get annoyed if we speak about him too much, because there's plenty of other things to talk about.
I'm very happy to talk about him as much as you like.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's just that, it's just that, you know. We've got to put bums on seats for this movie, so...
Absolutely. I enjoyed the movie, The Parole Officer. We're going to talk about it later. And it's a great film. But I think... let's talk about Alan! Well, it has been said, and certainly by you, indeed, that sometimes I try to emulate Alan Partridge. Really?
Yeah.
I think we've got it in Sunday People yesterday. Here we are. Look, it wasn't much of a story. Here's a little thing from on the showbiz page. Steve Coogan claims his TV comedy role as Alan Partridge is being ripped off by Big Breakfast star Richard Bacon.
That's not exactly what I said, but it is exactly what I meant.
OK, thanks very much. Well, you know, I hope that you are flattered. Where is that quote actually from?
My mouth.
Thanks very much. Okay, but you feel like generally do that to you?
No, I think in all seriousness, Rich. No, you know, it's not a serious programme. In all silliness. I know you came down to the show a couple of times we're recording it, but I think it's kind of because you start falling into. I was watching it one morning and went. He's falling into the Alan Partridge speech patterns. You're going, and so what it is, it's when you do something that goes a bit wrong, turn it into a joke, then no one will notice.
Yeah. And that does happen quite a lot. Well, let's have a look. We've got some clips, I think, of me from. I think more when I joined the show and I was doing the outside broadcast, I think maybe I lapsed into it a little bit more then. It's more to do with the way I sort of enunciate occasional things. But here we are, see what you think. Here's me on the outside broadcasts on this very show. Have a look at this. Okay. Can I come in?
You can, but it's such a mess.
Don't worry about that. What's your name?
Tracy.
Tracy, what we're doing is we're looking for some rubbish to sell to our viewers. Do you have anything? Anything at all? Surely you don't want these plates.
I like those plates.
You do?
Yes.
Okay. What will you, as a councillor, be doing to ensure that his single gets radio play?
Well, for myself, I shall certainly be buying it for all my friends for their Christmas presents.
But that's not going to help a radio station. You've got to do more than that. What will you do? Is that your answer? A disappointing answer from Councillor Needham, but thank you for coming down nonetheless. Hi guys, Richard Bacon, Big Breakfast. How you doing? All right, mate? So he knows that we're coming. She knows that we're coming. There we go. I mean, it's a little bit of the Alan speak in there, perhaps.
No, it's quite funny, but I won't be ripping you off, don't worry.
Thanks very much. OK. Now, we've got... we'll have a quick chat about Alan. First of all, how did he come about as a character, Alan Partridge?
We were doing a radio show, believe it or not, a real radio show, for Radio 4, and there's this script that just said sports presenter. And Armando, the producer, said, can you do a funny voice? So I came up with this voice. It was a bit more sort of like John Motson in those days, a bit more like that, and a little bit of David Coleman too, so it's all like and a bit John Motson. So, and it started to get more and more rounded, and eventually became Alan.
Yeah. It's a beautiful thing. And it's a bit of Titch Marsh and all sorts of different people in there.
It's a potpourri of lots of various different people.
Okay, thanks very much.
A bit of Richard Madeley, soup song of Richard Bacon.
Yeah.
Lots of people call Richard, basically.
But yeah, okay, absolutely right. And if you were, have you incorporated some of your own habits into Alan? Is there anything of yourself in the character, do you think?
Yes. I mean, I think Alan's a very, very anally retentive, and I'm slightly anally retentive.
Okay, okay, in what sort of a way?
Oh, sorry, I'll elaborate, yes. Sorry.
Yeah, okay. Could you?
I don't know, I suppose I sometimes get very annoyed about things. When I'm on the phone, you know, I sort of get very, very, I get annoyed. I can't believe, you know, are you being absolutely serious to me? I mean, who's in charge? What's your name? You know,
like that. Yeah, I do that.
And then I find out, I hear myself afterwards and think, oh, my God, you know.
Okay, well, we've got a clip here, one of the most famous clips. This is I think it's where you're trying to get a second series with the BBC.
Oh, yes.
You know the one, of course. Here we go. Here's Alan Partridge.
Got some cheese?
No, thank you.
It's quite nice. Smells. Do you want to smell it?
No, thanks.
Smell the cheese.
No, I don't want to smell it.
Smell my cheese.
Alan, please.
Smell my cheese, oh, mother!
No, I think that's quite enough, thank you.
I've got cheese! This is cheese! BBC. You're sitting round for, haven't you got programmes to make? No, you're on the BBC gravy train.
Yay! There we go. A great moment. Shame it's ended. But there we go. Thanks for grabbing the cheese with that one.
Do you want to smell it?
Not really. No, it's wrapped. It wouldn't work so well.
Smell it. Smell the cheese, Richard.
I don't really want to.
Smell my cheese, Richard.
Really does smell.
It does actually smell quite nice.
It's disgusting, isn't it?
Disgusting or quite nice, depending on if you're in a cheesy mood. Yeah, and I guess on the Big Breakfast, you've got to be.
Yeah. Okay, listen, obviously you've taken your character on the road. Do you enjoy performing live? Do you enjoy these characters performing live on stage?
Oh, it's great performing live because people laugh really loudly and then you get paid some money and you go home.
Yeah.
But television's it's more about, you know, you've got to sort of craft it and get it right. And then you go.
Which do you prefer? Do you think Partridge Rates better on stage or on television?
Well, better on telly. I mean, on stage, he's kind of a bit more, he's a bit sillier, not as subtle.
Okay.
It's kind of, on TV, you can do lots of little things. On stage, you've got to do lots of big things so people can notice you. So okay. He waved his arms about a lot, you know, or you do daft things like sing Kate Bush songs and stuff like that. Yeah.
Great moments. Listen, we're going to talk later about the parole officer and also a new TV series coming out. But thank you for talking to us in this special room with the Trouser Press. Steve Coogan. More with Steve and Papers and Charlotte, the harlot, in a couple of minutes.
Woo! Hey!
He was a favourite uncle of every would-be star.
Your host, Huey Green!
Behind this genial facade lay a private life littered with feuds, affairs, and illegitimate children.
That is show business.
The Real Huey Green, Tuesday at 10 on 4.
I'm Alan Partridge. Aha!
I'm Alan Partridge. Aha!
I'm Alan Partridge. Aha! Yay! Steve, I'm the best, aren't I?
That is the one. Definitely that one. But take the wig off. Take the wig off. You see, that's more like it. That's more like it. Oh, hang on. No, you've got a line for me. You had to cross the line, didn't you? You idiot.
Don't ruin our jokes.
I'm storming out.
Right. Just give me my script. I told you he'd like that, Charlotte.
Yes, Richard. Now it's the news and weather with Jasmine Lawson. Good morning. These are the main stories on Monday, the 6th of August. Body found in Aussie outback. Maddie's the most enviable of them all. And Maurice leaves them green. Australian police investigating the disappearance of British tourist Peter Falconio say they've discovered a body. However, they believe it's that of the 28-year-old tourist. It was found near the city of Alice Springs, 200 miles south from where Mr. Falconio and his girlfriend Joanne Lees were attacked in the Northern Territory over 3 weeks ago. Police say it was not wearing the same clothes as described by Ms. Lees at the time of the abduction. Police are expected to release an e-fit of a man they believe is responsible for planting the Ealing car bomb. Anti-terrorist investigators working in West London are hoping to finish their forensic fingertip search of the scene. They're keen to lift more of the cordons around the area devastated by Friday's blast and allow life to get back to normal as soon as possible.
We want to get residents back into their homes, living life as normal as possible,
traders up and running as quickly as possible and the road open as quickly as possible.
Residents in W's home state of Texas were forced to evacuate their homes after a train derailed carrying toxic material. 20 carriages fell off the track in Montgomery County. One of the containers was transporting a skin corrosive toxin called benzene. The latest attempt to be the first to fly a balloon solo around the world is into its second day. US millionaire Steve Fossett is expected to cross over Australia's east coast later, heading out over the Pacific Ocean towards New Zealand. The 57-year-old has already been forced to leave the capsule to repair a satellite antenna. Madonna's been voted the most enviable woman on the planet. A poll of British women placed the pop icon at the top of the pile for having the best bank account, brains and career. Posh Spice got the prize for best dressed, while former Spice mate Jerry hit a flat note, topping the worst voice category. Page Three stunner Jordan was the least envied for her talent and career. Here's the sport. Maurice Green picked up his third successive 100 metres title at the World Athletics Championships in Edmonton last night. The Kansas Cannonball clocked 9.82 seconds, with Britain's Dwayne Chambers coming in fifth. Earlier British hopes ended in the men's 400 metres. Mark Richardson and Ewan Thomas both failed to qualify from their semi-finals. With seven straight Ashes series wins over England, Australia's cricketers are demanding their prize. Aussie cricket captain Steve Waugh called on the old boys at Lord's to hand over the Ashes urn. Despite the Aussies' unbeatable 3-0 win at Trent Bridge, MCC officials say the Ashes belong to the club. Here's the weather. Temperatures should range from a low of 14 degrees in the Shetlands to 22 degrees in and around London. Expect a dull and cloudy start to the day with rain in many parts of Britain. Later showers will spread throughout the land, leaving only those in the north of Scotland dry. Here's the five-day forecast. Scotland and Northern Ireland will be cloudy and wet, but there will be the occasional glimpse of the sun too. In northern and central regions, the weather will improve as the weekend approaches, and the south follows a similar trend with wet weather early in the week, followed by a dry spell towards the weekend. That's it. Now it's back to the house.
Thanks very much, Jasmine. We've got we're going to resolve a winner from our competition.
Have we? Really exciting.
Yes. This is a West for Limerick, which you could win £1,000 of Charlotte's money. Charlotte's here.
They forced me to give this away, though.
Well, you're going to... OK,
here
we go.
I'm not happy.
OK. Well, you've got plenty to spare.
Oh, really? I won't have for long if I keep coming here.
There's a gorgeous young girl from Survivor, and I'd like to be sat down beside her. She's witty and fun, she's got a great bum, and she'd make a great lady. Lady Godiva.
Wonderful
image that you've created for us.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Riding horseback through Coventry.
And that's the winner.
Okay, sorry, who's it from?
Well, yes, let's find out the name.
Edwin. Well done, Edwin. Many congratulations.
You're a very rich man.
Okay.
Well, not as rich as me. Okay. Any joking.
Well done, sir. Thank you very much. Hope you're
Thank
enjoying
you.
Your time on the show.
Yes.
Okay, listen, that's the winner. Now, we're going straight to the newspapers now. We're not okay. Papers in a moment. First of all, we've got Snap, Crackle and Pop, and we're going to have a look at Britney Spears. Mm. And here is a bit for you of Showbiz News.
It's kind of sad, isn't it?
In today's film news, we join the rat race, get the lowdown on Britney's bed scene, and seconds of American Pie. John Cleese and Rowan Atkinson lead an all-star cast in upcoming movie Rat Race, which sees six everyday folk racing across America for $2 million.
First one there keeps it all.
It's like a race?
He said race.
Sounds rather like a reality game show. Would be Goldberg's one of the drivers.
Well, this is tame compared to, you know, Fear Factor and all those other... I mean, you know, when we made this movie, those shows weren't on. So the film takes it's not as absurd as one might think.
Seth Green, best known as Scott Evil and Austin Powers, thinks Rat Race is much healthier than Survivor and the like.
I think they're crazy. I think reality TV programming needs to be stopped. I think it's the downfall of the nation.
They're all like, who's having sex in the house? Who's eating someone else's flesh? It's like, ew.
Also competing for the prize is Road Trip's Brecken Meyer, who in real life would do anything for a bit of hard cash.
I ate mustard with cigarette ashes in it for $20. But they were Christian Slater's cigarette ashes, and I was kind of starstruck.
Thankfully, he behaved rather better when meeting his co-star, John Cleese.
He was so sweet. I called him Mr. Cleese and he corrected me. He said, it's Professor Dr. Cleese.
The rat race will commence later this year. Know what happens to Britney Spears early next year?
She loses her virginity.
Don't worry, folks. It's only a movie. Britney's deflowering happens in What Are Friends For? Her co-star, Taryn Manning, witnessed the momentous moment.
She wasn't really nervous at all. She just did her job. It was cool.
But in true pop princess style, Britney did the deed without shedding all her clothes.
Not everything. They get to see her in her underwear and her bra, though, which I know is going to be an awesome scene.
And could explain why test screenings of the Road Trip movie have been so favorable.
They're saying she's going to be as equally like of a movie star as she is a singer.
Yes, Britney sure has a pair of cracking talents. And finally, here's a look at the second helping of American Pie. This time, the boys are in college.
Where's my big guy?
Oh, no.
Hey!
Whoa! Get out, Dad!
Jim, we got here a little early.
Would you? Oh, my God!
Mom! Oh, Daddy! There's still the usual catchphrases.
This one time at band camp?
That's a lot of flutes.
The return of a certain Czech exchange student.
Nadia!
What?
Nadia?
New York!
She's not...
Hello?
What? Don't ride the subway after midnight.
Okay.
And at least one sticky situation we can't show all off.
Hands and we can see him! Get your other hand up!
I can't, I'm glued! Sorry.
American Pie 2 will be served in October.
That's Smurf, Ackle and Pop, and that was tremendous.
Yeah, wonderful.
Okay, now it's time for the newspapers. Yay! I apologise once again if I do appear at all tired, it's because of salmon. Okay, here we go. Let's start with the Daily Express. There's the headline this morning, which is teachers... Well, first of all, actually, just have a look at the word daily. You see there, they always have little slogans. Go right beneath the word daily. It says, start the week with Britain's best paper. Underneath daily. These are novice cameramen, Charlotte. They may not be able to find the word daily. There we go. But they do change the slogan regularly. Start the week with Britain's best paper. I will do that, and later I'll be reading The Sun. teachers, it says a headline here, teachers taught to fight pupils. Another Express exclusive, it says. Follows hot on the heels of their last exclusive from 1927. But it says, teacher, strange story this. I've been watching quite a bit of Brass Eye lately. And a lot of these stories now seem to me a bit... Steve Coogan here is, by the way. A lot of these stories actually seem a little bit like sketches now in papers, I find.
They do.
Particularly, they think teachers taught to fight pupils. Yeah. Teachers have been given lessons in self-defence to protect them from violent pupils and from lawyers, it says. Perhaps if gangs of lawyers going around schools with great big bats. You can just also see it on Brass Eye. Teachers at this school in Bromley and Kent have been fully trained in defence techniques, and a special ring has been built in the playground where they can slug it out with pupils during the lunch break.
Exciting stuff.
But obviously, I don't really understand the story entirely. Steve, would you agree with that? I think it's perhaps because it's silly season. But stories seem to take a surreal twist at the moment.
It's always silly season on the Big Breakfast.
Is it? Well, you're absolutely right. And thank you for pointing out that we are a shallow show. And we've got to also Melby spices up TV winner's moment. It says here that essentially what she did is she slept with the winner. Basically.
Really?
I made that up.
Nothing new there,
then. The story
Richard
seem more
in your wild imagination. Well, it really gets carried away.
I'm just trying to make the story seem more interesting. In fact, I've no idea what that little headline refers to because I couldn't be bothered to read the details. On the Daily Mail, My Cocaine Hell by Tara Palmer Tomkinson. Far too much made of this. What I would say is, taken in moderation, on the right occasion.
No,
Tara Palmer Tomkinson isn't that bad. Oh, what can I say? Blunkett to order detectives back on the beats is this here. You used to be a police officer.
I did. Everyone only becomes a detective.
Terrific.
To get off the beats.
Thousands of plainclothes police are to be ordered back to the beats. So they're going to put plainclothes police back in uniform.
That's
now.
Right.
Blunkett doesn't like plainclothes police officers.
Oh.
He wants more of a Blunkett believes many detectives would be more, rather than actually preventing crime, he thinks they'd be better off deterring crime. He thinks that's what policemen should now do. So you've got Sierra Oscar and 1 from Sierra Oscar 0. got a twok on a Ford Fiesta. Twok, that's taken
without... How do you know all about
taking
this?
Taken without
I'm
any
really
consent, Charlotte, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Thanks very
Your
much.
Your childhood woes.
OK, what should I do about the Ford Fiesta thief? Shall I arrest him? No, try and deter him. no, son, think
Sing
about...
Him.
Think about what are you getting yourself into. It's a Fiesta. It's got no air conditioning. the stereo's a bit ropey. And it's got a flat spot in third. I mean, that would mean, of course, that if you get rid of plainclothes officers, that would mean that Morse, Wexford, Frost, DS Beach, who I'm a big fan of, Bill Murray from the Bill, not
Fantastic.
Bill Murray from Ghostbusters, they'd all be shoved back into uniform. What are the facts, Lewis? Think about the evidence. Don't worry about the evidence, because we're only supposed to deter them now.
That's right.
That's what I have to say. Just go on, Steve Coogan's got the final headline there. It's the Daily Mirror. Brad and me, this was the hardest year of my life, says Jennifer Aniston.
I bet. With all that money, married to Brad Pitt.
Very difficult year negotiating that $1 million an episode deal.
I know.
Must be a lot of hard. And also...
I don't know how they cope.
Nor do I. That Batty is the headline there. This is about England chief Lord McLaurin bunked off to the races on the day England lost the Ashes. Sounds like sleaze to me. Last night, he was accused of deserting the players in their hour of need. Now, see, as I would argue, the English cricket team have many hours of need. I don't really think he can be expected to be there for every single one. But he went off to the races. He had much more fun watching thoroughbred horses rather than backing a bunch of donkeys at the cricket.
That
was a cheap joke, which I now regret, because I needed jokes to help me out this morning.
You do.
No, I didn't. I only said it because it's silly season. I sometimes go to the cricket. And I think, Steve, you'll agree with me here, there's a lot of promise in the current England cricket team.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. I mean, they say, you know, I've been watching it, and all I can say is it's just not cricket.
Yeah. You got a symbol crash there?
Why is it on the same
page? Thanks very much. Jonathan Kainer is causing some confusion in the Mirror today. And is, are you a fan of... Do you read your horoscopes, Steve?
No, I have them read to me. I pretend not to believe in them, and then I sort of secretly read them and secretly believe them.
Yeah, I do as well.
I love them.
But any Taurus, any Taurians here?
No, I'm
here?
Not Taurus.
If there is such a word. Taurus, today, listen to this, today's a day to chill out, but don't believe everything you're told.
Ah,
so where do you go with that advice, then?
You can't read the horoscope, then, can you?
No, it doesn't really make any sense, does it? All I say, John McCainer... No, but this does, and he tells you some advice and says, don't believe everything you read and everything you're told. All I'm saying is, I like to follow my horoscopes. I set my day by them. Please don't cause confusion. I know that you back me up on that.
Someone's been really reading these papers.
Yeah, I think they have. In a minute, by the way, I'm going to try and buy a snare drum. You'll be pleased to know.
I see it's the highlight of the show.
Do you know what? I might drop the John Prescott story. And Joe, I've only got a minute, so I'm going to try and buy a snare drum, because I need a snare drum. And this is for sale in the Yorkshire Evening Post. It's £130. I've only got a budget of £50. I'm going to try and get this guy down to 50.
Here we go. Snare.
OK, would you just hold that for me, Charlotte?
Right, yeah.
Thanks very much. I must do 141 first, otherwise he gets our number. We wouldn't want that. OK. 2, 3, 5, and I mustn't read it out. Just bear with me. OK, and there we go. So, I don't know if this is a part of a set, but it's a single snare drum. Maybe it comes from a marching band or something. It's hello there. Hello there. You're, this is Richard Bacon. You're live on The Big Breakfast. What's your name? Hello. Yes, I'm glad you find the concept amusing. What is your name?
Anne.
Anne, hello. Anne, I understand that you've got a snare drum for sale.
Yes, that's right.
Is it still for sale?
It is.
Is it, just intrigued to know, why are you selling a single snare drum? Was it part of a kit originally, or was it used in some kind of marching band?
No, my son bought it to practice on.
Right, OK. Why did he not want the rest of the kit?
Well, at the time, he couldn't afford to buy the rest of the kit, so he bought the snare drum.
Right, and has he now gone off the snare drum?
He's now got a full kit.
Right, OK. Right, I see. So he's got two snare drums. Listen, I need one at home. I'd be delighted to buy it off you. You're offering it at £130. I've only got a budget of 50 quid.
Right.
Will you go down to 50 quid?
No.
Listen, I can guarantee, look, more for you, I can guarantee you a sale. I don't think there's that, I bet there's not that much demand in North Yorkshire for snare drums.
Yeah, well, the thing is, we've actually had an offer on it.
Yes, how much was the offer?
Well, over 100.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Whoa.
Is that true?
What about if would you not prefer to sell the snare drum to a minor celebrity?
That's if you're telling me the truth.
No, I am telling you the truth. I don't quite know how to confirm that you are on the Big Breakfast, but you're obviously not watching it this morning. Listen, I'm going to have to finish this. But listen, it is Richard Bacon. I present a TV show. I'd be delighted to send you an autograph.
Which is of course.
Listen, I'm not really that self-important. I'm just being silly.
Anyway, calm down. Hang up the phone.
Listen, can I have it 50 quid and an autograph? Yes or no?
No.
Right.
That's it. We've got God's gift.
Okay. Ooh. Yes, we have. Okay, so we're going to give away some prizes in just a moment.
We are, apparently.
Let's go to this.
In the beginning, I said, let there be light. And there was light. Then I created a multitude of beautiful things and called it Earth. I then filled it with small, ugly things. That's your lot. But above all... Before I rested on the seventh day, I created God's gift.
God's gift!
There we go. Yes, today in God's gift, you could win this Palm Top DVD player. Top DVDs are worth a fortune, and we're giving that away to mark the special edition retail DVD and video release of The Silence of the Lambs, the Academy Award-winning thriller starring Sir Anthony Hopkins as Dr. Hannibal Lecter.
Lovely.
For legal reasons, stick to the script.
Yes, all right then. God's Gift includes this fully portable DVD player with built-in screen, ooh, plus a two-disc special edition copy of the film that includes deleted scenes, hooray, and extra features.
OK. Ah. To enter God's Gift, phone God on 0900 1222 with your answer to the following question. Here it is. Which feline pop stars are number one this week? Is it A, Catatonia? Is it B, Bagpuss? Or is it C, Atomic Kitten? Ooh, that number again, Charlotte.
0900 1229900.
Can I say this presenting thing is going very well?
I know, it's exciting.
Okay, our man. Listen, thanks, Charlotte. Listen, we'll give that away. We'll announce it. You don't have to do anything special. Just call us. It's a tremendous prize, and you may well be on the air later. I'm sure you'll find that a treat. Coming up after the break, we are going to talk again with Steve Coogan. We'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Don't you just wish that every weekday was like a T4 Sunday?
Well, rub me up and call me a genie in a bottle, because now, starting at 9 every weekday on Channel 4...
There's this.
Hello and welcome to T4.
And then from 2 on E4, you can see this.
Hello and welcome to E4.
Wicked, let's see it again. 9 o'clock, Channel 4. 2 o'clock,
hello.
E4. 9 o'clock,
hello.
2 o'clock.
Hello. Man, will you stop that? You're making me dizzy.
T4, weekdays from 9 and then on E4 from 2.
Welcome back to the show. After being told that Rada didn't need his help, he was turned down from Rada.
No!
Our next guest this morning turned his talents to creating comedy characters and didn't essentially do too badly. Please welcome, once again, Britain's brightest comedian, Steve Coogan. Yay! Just terrific to have you on the show. Have you enjoyed the morning so far?
Oh, I'm having a fabulous time.
So pleased that you are. Thank you. Now, your new film... Stop giggling. Your new film is it's The Parole Officer. And which I enjoyed through it the other day. And first of all, let's talk a bit about the film. Tell us a bit about it and why you chose to play a parole officer.
I wanted to do something that was different, and I thought, well, yeah, I'll do something that's got a little bit of Alan Partridge in, but a bit more of me in. Mm. And and also I didn't want to do a character where I had to put lots of wigs and jumpers on and things.
Sure.
Like that. So I thought I'd do something that was where I could wear clothes that were kind of normalish.
Yeah.
Rather than blazers and cravats.
But often with your characters, you're sort of championing buffoons and that kind of thing. And Mike Crystal is a character you play in this film. Is he a buffoon, do you think? Do you call him a buffoon?
Mike Crystal, what from? Mike Crystal. Mike Crystal's the thing I did on Coogan's Run.
I'm sorry, sir.
No, the character in the parole officer. Good research, very.
No, I'm sorry. Do you know? Can I just apologise again for my lack of sleep? And that's entirely my fault.
I play a character called Simon Garden, and he robs a bank. To get a tape out that proves his innocence of a murder that he's been wrongfully convicted of.
Yes.
Wrongful conviction.
It is. So. And it's we'll have a look at a clip so we know exactly what we're talking about.
Okay.
So here is our first clip of the parole officer.
That makes sense.
I shouldn't have had that story, but I'm all right now.
Terrific. There we go. You see, look, you must be pleased to see that it goes down a treat with a live crowd here, which it did. Mm. I watched the props. Mm. They have been sitting around for some time.
That's just made me hungry, all that sick.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, Simon Garden, the character in that, of course. Now, this isn't your first film. I remember seeing a film which you... did you play a toy soldier, didn't you, I think, in your first film?
I played a toy soldier in an American film called The Indian in the Cupboard.
Yeah.
I'm in it for about, sort of, 10 seconds. I did it in Hollywood.
Yeah, nice experience over there.
Oh yes, it was very interesting. I did all the thing, hired a convertible Mustang, drove up and down Sunset Boulevard, in the rush hour with the roof down.
Right.
Everyone staring at me, this sort of layer of smog coming down, me coughing like that, and then and everyone pointing, going tourist.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. A bit like Americans over here hiring limos and things. But, okay. But yeah, I mean, you're trying to move into films now. Actually, is that your
intention? Well, I just thought I've done telly and I've been funny on telly. I wonder if I can try and be funny on film. So that's what. And I think I've succeeded. In fact,
yes.
Hang on, I have succeeded. Yeah.
Well, you're absolutely right. It's very true. But also, there's a number of cameos in the parole officers. A number of cameos from different people. And apparently, David Bowie was going to be in it, though, wasn't he?
It was mooted at some point. Now, at the end of the film, basically, we used the track Heroes, David Bowie's track, and we thought it would be really great if he could sing it. And he said no, so we thought, well, we'll just play it anyway and dance to it.
As simple as that, he just said no. He was asked straight no.
I think he said, I don't want to do it. It sounds like a very interesting job. I didn't take the call, but I'm imagining that's what he probably
said. Yes, I figured you were. Thanks very much. OK, let's have another good clip from the parole officer. This is a great scene with you negotiating with two guys on a roof. Here's a clip.
Right, listen, can I just say something? If you attack me, I will go to the police, it will be reported, you'll have a criminal record. You've got one, okay. In my wallet, I've got £40. That's 20 each. Plus a cash card. It's got a £200 limit, of which I've withdrawn 40. You've got that. Now, the PIN number, it's the Battle of Hastings.
Oh! Yeah. Great clip. Is it, you co-wrote this film with Henry Normal. Is it a different, I don't know, discipline writing for a film? Is it more subtle compared to writing for television?
It's just harder.
Is it?
It's just harder and it's longer. It's not like writing 3 half-hour and then stitching them all together. It's sort of a 90-minute film. You've got to do things like sort of do character arcs and make the character. See, at the end of a sitcom, character always ends up the same as he was at the beginning. But but this is the more difficult. You've got to do other characters. And I had to share my funny lines out. I had to give funny lines to other people to say, which is
That must have been hard.
Very difficult. Very difficult. But I tried to share some. When I was writing it, Henry would say, "Oh, that's a really funny line." He said, "Well, do you want it?" And I go, "Well, let's share them out." And he went, "Well, do you want to be funny or do you want other people to be funny?" And I went, I want to be funny. Yeah. I shared some of them out. I was generous, but I wasn't stupid.
No, of course. You took the bulk of the funny lines.
Yeah, the best lines.
Yeah, absolutely.
I gave other people quite funny ones.
Okay. Right choice. Listen, mate, thanks for coming on the show. And the parole officer, I enjoyed it a lot. And it's out on Friday, isn't it? In cinema on Friday?
It's out on Friday in the cinemas. It's very funny. The weather looks like it's going to be really bad. Probably a good idea was, instead of sitting in the garden under all the rain, probably best to kind of go to the cinema and maybe watch the film.
Yeah, it's an absolutely great idea. Okay, listen, Steve. And also, by the way, you've got a new TV series coming out as well. Should I mention that quickly?
In the autumn, yeah. Dr. Terrible's House of Horrible. I play Dr. Terrible and I'm horrible.
And are you also funny?
Ish.
OK, thanks very much. All right, Steve, great to meet you. Thanks for coming on the show. Really pleased you came down. Steve Coogan! Yeah! I'm touched by the scene. Do you want to do a bit of presenting, Steve? Do you want to have a go at that? You can read that out if you like. So to you.
OK. This week trail.
That's
that doesn't make sense.
Listen, here's what's coming up this week.
Oh, this week?
Coming up on this week's star-studded Big Breakfast. Top funny man Ben Miller gives us the lowdown on his hilarious new movie. We get Out of Control with Dance Masters The Root and UK Garage Kings, DJ Luck and MC Neat. We'll be popping in for a chat. Plus, in Snap, we catch up with Angelina Jolie and Antonio Banderas at the premiere of their new movie. We talk Aya Napa with dance gurus Groove Armada, plus the return of Brit Rocker's Embrace. All this and much, much more on The Big Breakfast. Don't leave home without it.
There we go, that's Steve Coogan there, and also there's a trail. Now listen, earlier on we asked you, we're offering, this is what's up for grabs today. It's a palm top DVD, courtesy of God. And the question we asked was, which pop stars are at number one this week? Was it A, Catatonia, B, Bagpuss, or C, Atomic Kitten? The correct answer was, of course,
Atomic Kitten.
Well done, Charlotte. We're going to go. Well, we've got somebody on the line now. Well, we have several people waiting there. They don't know which one has won. So you tell them we'll have a fanfare. It'll go well. Right. Who is it?
The winner is, boom, 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 Rebecca from Bognor Regis.
Yay!
You are fine. Okay. And, of course,
yes. Yes, you've won that, and I have a palm top myself, and let me assure you, it's a lot of fun. OK, listen, well done, and in a moment we're going to talk about game shows, because you've appeared on 5 or 6.
Yes, I have, just a few.
Including Play Your Cards Right and Whatever You Want with Gabby Rosalie, which I imagine was just a tremendous experience.
But now, it's time for the break.
Back to the show. And I thought we'd outlawed whooping. Charlotte is in the house.
Hello.
And that's just terrific. And obviously more from you, and we're going to enjoy your presenting skills.
Thank
you. I'll give you some tips later, who knows?
Oh,
we're going live to ITN. We're 2 minutes late, 3 minutes late, good heavens. Here's Jasmine Lowson.
Good morning. These are the main stories on Monday, the 6th of August. Police say Outback body unlikely to be Peter. Perrier Awards risk losing its fizz, and some like it hot. Police investigating the disappearance of a British tourist in central Australia have discovered the body of an unidentified man. However, they think it's unlikely to be that of Peter Falconio, who's been missing since he and his girlfriend Joanne Lees were ambushed over 3 weeks ago, just north of Alice Springs. Forensic experts at the scene say the clothing did not match the type worn by Peter when he disappeared. The body was found about 40 miles south of Alice Springs yesterday afternoon. Scotland Yard are thought to be close to releasing an eFit photograph of the man they believe planted last week's Ealing bomb. Forensic experts are expected to complete their fingertip search for evidence today, allowing business and homeowners to assess the damage done to their properties. Today's the day for Northern Ireland's pro-agreement parties, who are supposed to give their response to the latest peace-saving package. But both sides are likely to let the deadline pass. The Ulster Unionists want movement on IRA weapons decommissioning, while Sinn Féin would like more information on police reform. Farmers in the Brecon Beacons will find out the results of foot and mouth tests on 4,000 sheep later. It comes as ministers launch an inquiry into compensation payments made to farmers. Nearly 40 have received £1 million for their livestock. past winners of the Perrier Awards at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival are calling for a boycott of this year's prize. Emma Thompson and Rob Newman, who won in 1981, are protesting the marketing of powdered baby milk in developing countries by Perrier's owners Nestle. Yesterday saw the festival kick off with a parade through the city where some 1,400 shows will take place over the next 3 weeks. Tropical storm Barry is expected to hit the Florida coast shortly, packing winds of 70 miles an hour. Thousands of residents have evacuated their homes, with the storm expected to build up to a hurricane before making landfall at about 10 this morning.
Everybody's trying to get out of town. I was here at 6 a.m. this morning, and everybody's just trying to leave.
We do want people to know that they can expect a Category 1 hurricane, and even a Category 1 hurricane is almost always have some loss of life, and that's what we want to prevent.
12 photos of Marilyn Monroe, taken just 6 weeks before she died, are to go under the hammer on the net. They were taken by 60s photographer Bert Stern and show Marilyn flirting. They're one of five collections of dye transfers remaining. The photo lab technician, who was given them 30 years ago, hopes she hasn't lost any of her sex appeal since they were taken. Here's a look at the weather. Temperatures should range from a low of 14 degrees in the Shetlands to 22 degrees in and around London. Later, most of Britain will be hidden beneath a vast sheet of rain cloud. Only the north of Scotland will escape. That's the Big Breakfast news. Now back to the house.
Okay, cheers. Thanks very much, Jasmine. And there we go. And you're okay there. Just sort of a quick release type top there, which looks just tremendous.
In your jeans, Richard.
You can borrow it if you want, Richard.
Yeah, I don't tend to wear women's clothing that often.
So he says.
No, listen, get her off. No, I do like Jasmine. Please don't email, say that I'm rude, because I'm not. Right. Okay, now listen, you may remember last week that I offered a service to the viewers, which was that I would come to your wedding, because I enjoy weddings. And
lack of friends.
We've got a... Not at all. No, not at all, Charlotte. We got a great response and a great couple, Kevin and Lisa Marie from Southampton. They contacted the show and said, Richard, we'd love you to come down. And really, it was about me presenting a bit of a wedding video, adding some minor celebrity. Yeah. They even let me do a reading at their service.
Isn't that sweet?
So that's what I did.
They must be mad.
I want them to know I had a great day and love meeting all your family. And now you can see how I got on when I went to Kevin and Lisa Marie's wedding.
Woo! Bacon at your wedding.
Being Richard Bacon means that occasionally I'm asked to give up some of my time to perform public duties. Normally I refuse via email or by fax. But when a young couple from Southampton asked me to come and present and star in their wedding video, I simply couldn't refuse. Well, here the bride arriving on the scene. This is Lisa. In the carriage there with the horse. We're in Netley Marsh, just off junction 2 of the M271. She's about to make the walk, but not before she's met one Richard Bacon. Lisa, hello there. I'm Richard from The Big Breakfast.
Hi.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
On having me here. This is a garter belt, have a look at that.
Right,
and
lovely.
It's got my picture. Bacon at your wedding, it says.
Right.
Do you want to take that now? Would you mind choosing very quickly, it's just a quick choice, which TV theme you'd like us to cut your highlights package to? You've got Rockford Files, Knight Rider, Airwolf, Taxi. In editing terms, Quantum Leap is very good, as is Cagney and Lacey.
That's fine.
Quantum Leap.
Yeah.
Lisa, best of luck.
Thank you.
Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God.
Can I have your autograph, please, Rich?
Yeah, of course you can. It's late in the afternoon now, and the action has moved on here to this specially erected marquee for the reception. Really, this is a chance for everyone to let their hair down. And Lisa and Kevin have honoured me by giving me pride of place on the top table, from where I'll be making
my speech. I have known Lisa Marie and Kevin for 4 hours and 12 minutes. It feels like five. Already, I've got to like them immensely. Throughout the whole time I've known Kevin, I've never, ever heard him have a bad word to say about anyone. And just finally, this is Radio 1 DJ Scott Mills. He says, I'm not the marrying type. But all the best to Lisa Marie and Kevin. You might not know who Scott Mills is, but he does the graveyard shift on Radio 1. He's not that much cop, but he's a good DJ. He's a good DJ on occasion, but that is a message from him. But it's been a really great day. I won't bore you any longer, but I'll just do a toast to the bride and groom. Thank you.
My speech had been a rip-roaring success, and it was almost time to say goodbye. But before I went, I wanted to give the newlyweds one piece of advice.
Lisa Marie and Kevin, thank you for having me. I have got to go now. I've got a screening of Planet of the Apes. But can I just say this before I go? Marriage is sacrosanct. I think the bond between a bride and a groom is very much like that between me and the viewers. We wake up together each morning. I share with them my innermost feelings, and when they are away, I am but half a man. Cheers, guys.
That's all right,
thank
no problem.
And you can hear my views on Planet of the Apes later in the week.
Thank you. I just want to say what a great day I had there. And really, Lisa Marie and Kevin, everyone, and many. They are watching.
Right in,
I think so. No, they are watching this morning. They're going on their honeymoon later this week. And I just want to say I had a great day. And thank you for having me once again. And, you know, if you'd like me to come to your wedding, then I'm sure there are many people out there watching, looking at how happy Kevin and Lisa Marie were, and thinking, I'd love to have Richard Bacon at my wedding. Here we go. It's a big breakfast. Lot Keepers, Cottages, Old Ford, Lock, London, E3, 2NN. There we go. Please drop us a line. Now, what's happening after the break, Charlotte?
Coming up, game show and tell.
Wow.
That's to do with me,
this
isn't it?
Yeah, Charlotte's been on many game shows. So we'll be talking about that in a couple of minutes. Welcome back to the show. Now, Mandy from our Family of the Week has been trying to get on game shows for years. And she hasn't managed to get on a single one. Mandy, have you? Not even Jerry Springer's Greed. Mummy fears are over because co-presenting this morning's show is Charlotte from Survivor. You're really, in many ways, the queen of game show contestants because you have been on many game shows.
I have.
You?
It's certainly better than working for a living.
Okay. which means it must be time for
game show and tell.
Okay. Now, first of all, Mandy, why are you so keen to get on the game show?
I want to win all the prizes, all the money that Charlotte's won.
That money has gone. How many have you applied for, Mandy?
Hundreds, about 20.
Have you?
Yeah.
And do you send a letter to the different shows? And
yeah, I send all the different letters when I'm bored.
And how many have you actually got on to?
None.
Okay. And Charlotte, you've been on loads and made a fortune.
I know, it's great.
Okay. And you've even won a car, haven't you, on the
Player
Cars,
yes.
Right? A million pounds from Survivor.
I know, that was the jackpot.
Okay. What inspired you to go on to game? Why did you want to be on game shows, Charlotte?
Well, I just thought it was a bit of excitement, a bit of fun, and something different. And obviously, you win loads of prizes. And
yes,
here I am
okay.
Now, a million.
Well, listen, I find this very exciting because you were on Gabby Roslin's Whatever You Want. But I don't think you were too successful on the show. I don't think it went very well.
No, because there's a bit of a story behind that, you see, because...
After the clip!
All right, guys!
OK, here we go.
Now, Charlotte, you are mad about the bill, aren't you?
I am. I absolutely love it. I've watched it for ages, ever since I was a younger teenager, and I just love the storylines. I think they're great.
Who's your favourite character?
Dave Quinnan, I think. He's always the one doing pranks and everything. I think he's excellent.
You know, I'm sorry, but you don't look like... Can I just bring her around the front? You've all got to see these legs apart from... Look at this policewoman! Give them a twirl, because look at her hair as well! Oh, you just look stunning.
Ah, I was a baby!
Wow, you see, now I see why you wanted to be on Survivor in the bikini and...
That's right,
look great. Now, listen, Charlotte, you seem to get accepted regularly to game shows.
I know.
What advice can you give Mandy? Do you yourself write letters and that kind of thing?
Well, yeah, you do write letters, but if you put in lots of hobbies and interests, try and make it a little bit different, make yourself stand out, a little bit exciting, like, you know, go and do a skydive, then you can write it down.
Is that what the short skirt was for? Was that to help you on your way?
Well, you know, I was already there then, wasn't I? I was
okay.
Already picked.
You didn't send a picture of you.
What, to Gabby?
Yes.
Yes, and she loves me.
Okay. Why did you choose to wear such a short skirt when you're going to be behind a podium?
Well, I just thought it was kind of a bit sexy and sassy and sweet, and I thought, why not?
What a terrific idea. Okay. Now, let's move on. Now, you've sent off letters, and we've got a... have you been on Noel's house party, by the way, Charlotte?
I have, yes.
Noel's house party!
Yes! I'm guilty.
Okay. Now, so your first tip to Mandy really was to send your letter off, include hobbies, more details about yourself.
Lots of details. Put loads down, everything down, and make yourself interesting. Pretend.
Okay. And this is obviously useful for anyone watching who also wants to be on game shows. But let's go to a clip of you then on Noel's house party.
That will continue to play. If you're listening on the radio in the West Coast, you know that is still playing. And of course, let me just underline, they have no idea that the rest of the nation is watching on BBC One. So we'll go and sort Charlotte out in a moment.
Embarrassing stuff, that.
Right, no, it's
completely great. Set up.
Was it? Why were you dancing in that clip, Charlotte?
Well, I really don't know. I must have lost my mind or something. Yes. But I didn't know the cameras were on at that time. And
okay.
It's the sort of thing I do in my living room.
Okay, well, now, how did you get onto that highly entertaining show? That was MTV section, was it?
Yeah, colleague set me up for that one.
Okay. Did that colleague know that you were TV hungry?
Yes, he did. Right. You see, you've got to tell all your family and friends that you really want to get on TV and they'll help
you. Is that tip number two for Mandy?
Definitely tip number two. Tell everyone.
Tell everyone and just hope that one of them sets you up on telly. Okay, terrific. Okay, now then, the next show you get on to is the more traditional Saturday night television show. Play your cards right. And you had to... did you have to have an audition for this, I understand, and that sort of thing?
Yeah, auditions for everything.
Okay,
Smile.
Now, Mandy, you applied for this show as well.
Yeah, we got an audition.
Right, what happens at the audition?
There was about 15 people sat around in
a
circle.
Did they have a load of big cards and things and or anything like that?
No,
okay.
No, nothing like that.
What sort of things did they make you do at the audition?
We had to play the game.
Yes.
Play cards right. We won, I think. We won the game.
Why didn't you get on the show, Mandy?
I think we were a bit too shy.
Okay, there we go.
They missed out.
All right. And who else has rejected you, Mandy? Which other game shows?
Most of them.
Okay. But there's one specifically that why don't you tell us about.
Supermarket Sweep.
And we can have a look at your letter here, which your rejection letter. We're just going to put this up on the screen. And I've got it in my hand, and it says, Dear applicant, nice for such personal touch. Thank you for your application for Dale's Supermarket Sweep. Unfortunately, we did not make any programmes in 2000. And at present, this is an exclusive in many ways.
Exclusive.
There are no plans for another series.
No!
That's terrible. You were unlucky, really. And I imagine that Dale has pulled out. If the makers are there, I am more than happy to appear on... Well, I'm more than happy to host that show for you.
With me.
OK, listen, we've got a clip. Charlotte, have you been on the show?
No, I haven't.
We've got you on Play Your Cards Right, though.
Oh,
which
excellent.
We can have a look at now. Here's Charlotte.
Ooh. Yes.
How many vets said yes? They had come across a colleague who enjoyed taking a cow's temperature, and they gave him a pat on the head.
I don't know, it depends what kind of person you are, doesn't it?
What day?
Depends what kind of person you are. If it's in the winter, keep your hands warm.
Keep keep your hands
warm. But I still think it'd be quite low.
Oh, that was just terrific. And there we are, and that lovely clip there, and there's Bruce.
Right.
And
quite rightly so.
So you made him laugh as well.
I did. Nice. Oh, he's lovely, Brucey.
Is he a really nice guy?
He's fabulous.
Okay. Did he meet you before the recording?
He did. He warmed up everyone, you know, true professional.
Just
Richard.
Terrific. Listen, we're going to finish this. A final tip. Obviously, a lot of people out there want to be on game shows. What is your final tip for everyone, and of course, Mandy, for getting onto game shows?
You must never, ever give up. Keep on applying and applying and.
How much money have you won altogether from game shows? How much money have you won?
I can possibly.
You won more than one car?
No, just the one.
What
car.
What make of car was it?
A Daewoo.
Oh dear. Okay, never mind. Listen, thank you very much, and thank you for your tips.
Thank you.
Mandy, and of course, Charlotte. Yay! We're going to be back after the break with a bit more shenanigans and a few other bits and bobs. So please rejoin us in a couple of minutes. So welcome back. We've just got to show you some these are new things that are on the market at the moment. Paul Daniel started the trend when he placed that dead ferret on his head. Yes, I'm talking about uses for dead animals.
Oh.
This is a lovely feature. I know that you've been looking
fabulous.
Forward to this, Charlotte.
Yes.
The products you're about to see are both dead and available on the internet. And here we go. And here's our first one, which is it's a kangaroo back scratcher. Let me hold them up. It's better for lighting. That's a kangaroo on. And here, this is a crocodile back scratcher.
Bargain price.
15 quid. That's 15 quid and £13. They come with a guarantee to prove that they are real. Please let me hold them still for you so you can enjoy this.
I wonder if that's illegal.
What if you've got some sort of game show music that I can spin them round and you can really enjoy these different little prizes. And look at those. And they're absolutely real.
Please,
I know that some people will be offended by this.
I'm offended.
Are you really?
No. Well, as long as they didn't die just to become a back scratcher.
What's nice about the? Well, I mean, there's every chance they did, isn't it? I've no idea about the origin of these things.
Then.
Listen, what you've got is you've got very sharp nails.
That's
this
right.
will get deep into your back. Do you have an itchy back?
Not at the moment, no.
Okay. Do you ever have an itchy back?
Sometimes.
Okay. Well, you're not going to demo it for us now, but there we go. We've got a cane toad purse.
It's
10 quid on the internet if you want this. It has a label which guarantees it's genuine. There you go.
Does it go all slimy? When wet?
It probably does. But there you go. It's a cane toe purse, £10.
Poor
but finally,
thing.
And the most exciting one. This is horrific in many ways, Tom. But this is the most exciting
one
of the lot.
I hope it shocks you.
You'll like this, ladies and gentlemen. It's a kangaroo scrotum purse. And that's ladies and gentlemen.
Quite disgusting.
Don't be afraid to touch. Don't be afraid to touch the scrotum.
No,
Charlotte.
No, please. You keep your scrotum to yourself. Thank you.
Anyone else want to hold a scrotum?
No.
Jody, would you like to hold a scrotum?
I really do not want to hold that.
Are you sure? It's quite just
feels
like normal
leather.
Doesn't
that make you feel pain talking about that?
Yeah, definitely.
Do you know this is only £7, and
is that all a kangaroo scrotum is worth?
Okay. Okay. Listen, are you sure? It's quite, it just feels
I'm
like
sure.
leather. For goodness' sake, pathetic. Okay, listen. There we go. That's on the net as well. And I hope you enjoyed those. And I hope we've encouraged some of you to buy them. That would increase demand for scrotum. No,
yes.
I'm sorry. Listen.
Thank you very much. But coming up next, we've got Jasmine Lawson with the Big Breakfast News and Weather.
Excellent presenting, Charlotte.
Yay!
The closing headlines. The Ulster Unionists and Sinn Féin will dismiss today's supposed deadline to respond to the latest peace proposals. IRA weapons decommissioning and RUC reforms are still the main sticking points. The parents of missing teenager Danielle Jones are to appeal for information about her disappearance. Along with local police, Tony and Linda Jones will hand out leaflets about their daughter's last known movements. The 15-year-old's been missing for 7 weeks. Police reports due to be submitted today on allegations Mike Tyson raped a woman 2 weeks ago. It'll be studied by prosecutors in California to decide whether the boxer should be charged. Here's a look at the weather. Temperatures should range from a low of 14 degrees in the Shetlands to 22 degrees in and around London. Later, most of Britain will be hidden beneath a vast sheet of rain cloud. Only the north of Scotland will escape its clutches. That's it from the news team today. Now back to the house.
Hey, thanks very much, Jasmine. Excellent start to your week. And here we are. I'm being nice to you. You've been out in the sun. You're lovely tan there. You're sort of more tan than normal. Or is that just makeup?
Just makeup, I think.
Okay, yeah. Well, thank you very much. Look at that sort of grimace that she
always
wears.
Whenever
I talk to her.
You're always so complimentary.
You've been very nice today, Richard.
Okay, thank you. Well, there we are. That's enough. Come on, turn it on! Okay, it's nearly the end of the show. It's 8:57. And this is obviously another one. Do you keep tapes of all the shows that you appear on?
Well,
there's
no,
so many.
I couldn't possibly. I haven't got a house big enough, although I might be right. I tape you, Richard.
What are the shows are you... what are the shows are you hoping to appear on? Any other applications?
Oh, I don't know. Something exciting. Might go into movies or something.
Well, yes. You might do.
Yes.
Emphasis on the might. OK, listen, Charlotte, tremendous to have had you here.
Thank you very much.
A great job, really. As a teacher. You've got a nice day planned.
Wonderful. I think I'm going straight back to bed.
Okay, terrific. Listen, tomorrow, Amanda is back from her brief holiday. Oh. Also tomorrow, lots more shenanigans. I trust that you'll be watching from your bed.
Of course.
Okay.
But now I think it's time for us to say goodbye.
It is time for us to say goodbye. You can say what you like.
Go ahead. All our guests, we've got Steve Coogan.
Okay. Yay!
Jody Bunting. Rochelle. Family of the week.
Okay. Well done. Tomorrow, last one. Do you ever get tempted to get your £1 million in cash, lay it out on a bed and sleep on it?
I've done it.
Have you? See you tomorrow.
To whoever decides what goes out on my telly, you've got to make it better, man. Just give it some more welly. That's why I'm sitting here just writing you this letter. You gotta do something, man, to make my heart is better. You should put C4 on most every other day. I know that you can do it, just please find a way. How about at 9 o'clock it's on Channel 4? Then from 2 in the afternoon, E4 shows it more. The shows are simply heaving and the presenters are just class. Especially that Vernon, he's gotta tidy. Ask anyone, man, they'll tell you it's the money. T4 with Vernon, June and MT, she's such a honey. Anyway, man, I hope you get this letter. As always, I am your biggest fan.
Vernon, that bit don't rhyme.
T4, weekdays from 9 and then from 2 on E4.